So let's get right to it. So you have the title there and the plan. So it's a model for inventory growth cycles, but actually didn't start as a model for inventories. The inventories were something that came into existence in the model because we were trying to solve other problems. So you see how it comes about, but it became a model for inventories. And then when I was writing the introduction for the paper, as you know, the introduction is the last thing that you write, right? You get all the results and then you think about what to say in the introduction. So just for fun, I decided to look at the neoclassical, the mainstream literature for inventories. And there are striking parallels between the issue of introducing inventories in neoclassical models and the issue of introducing money in neoclassical models, because if you have something that is has perfect foresight and equilibrium, there should be no need for inventories. In the same way that there's no need for financing, because there's optimal capital allocation and so on and so forth. So the difficulties of having a micro-founded neoclassical model that has inventories at a macroeconomic level are similar, very analogous to the difficulties of having a model with banking and finance. So that's very good for people doing things outside the mainstream, because it's an opportunity to have an alternative and more natural way to introduce those concepts. But nevertheless, here are some stylized facts about inventories that we should keep in mind. For example, even though they represent a very small portion of output, so if you look every year, you look at GDP of a country and how much of the GDP is the investment in inventory. So you have, out of GDP, you have consumption, you have investment, and then the investment in capital, and there is a small portion of investment that is investment in inventory. Well, that is very small, it's about 1%. However, when there are changes in GDP, in particular when there are recessions, so large contractions in GDP, the overwhelming proportion of the change, something like 60% on average, but this was for a paper that was looking only at recessions up until 1981, but more recent papers recalculate that and is even a larger proportion, something like on average 80% of the change in GDP is due to change in inventory. So obviously it's a very volatile component of GDP because it corresponds to most of the change in GDP itself. So there's something interesting already there. And this is for example, this is what it says. For example, in
good grief.
Yeah.
I teach one time. Don't worry. You won't get it in your
right. For example, for this recession here in 48-49, there was a $22 billion drop in GDP through the cycle, and there was a $28 billion drop in investment in inventory. So not only was a large component, it was even larger than the drop in GDP. It was 120% of the drop in GDP. But you get the picture. This was an outlier. It was a short recession where inventories didn't play much of a role. But you see what the overall picture is. So here are other stylized facts that you should keep in mind. So the first item is what we just discussed. It's more volatile than output itself. And in particular, it's more volatile than output minus inventory. So that's just sales. It's counter-cyclical, but only if you look at high frequencies. So like a couple of quarters. If you look at the business cycle frequencies, so several years, so 8 to 40 quarters, then it's pro-cyclical. So that already should give you some hint that inventories are something that play in different time scales. And this is a concept that is going to be of importance later on in the model. It's not something that is only at the time scale of the business cycle itself, and it's not something only at the small fluctuation time scale. It's a combination of both. And it behaves differently in the two frequencies. production is less volatile than sales at a high frequency, and is more volatile in the business cycle or lower frequency. This is not. This is just because there's some equations in the model that will make reference to that fact as well. And yes, most of the variance in inventory investment is concentrated at high frequencies rather than at low frequencies. However, if you look at the other components of GDP, for example, capital investment, the majority of the variance of capital investment is over longer frequencies. So this is to get you familiar with the idea that somehow inventories are different than the other regular components of GDP that you might be used to analyzing, like consumption and investment. Okay, now what about theory? So you look for, as a DSG model would look, for a micro-founded theory. Maybe it's not the best place to look, but that's what most people look. And the idea there is that in the theory of how a firm behaves, inventory is a stabilizing factor. You want to smooth out production over a long period. You have different costs. You don't know. You have uncertainty in sales. So you build up some inventory to smooth out the fluctuations that you have in production because you don't know what sales are going to be. So, but how come that a stabilizing factor in a macroeconomic context becomes a more volatile portion of the quantity that you're trying to stabilize, which is output itself? So this is a paradox, and it's as I said, it's very hard to have a fully micro-founded DSG model with a proper place for inventories. They have to contort themselves into several theories of frictions and different motives, stock avoidance, stock out avoidance motive, for example. It's going to be very, very embarrassing if a client walks into your store and wants to buy something and you don't have it displayed. So to prevent that, you build up inventory, even though that increases volatility, if you like. Anyways, so we look at a different starting point. So not GSD, not micro-founded model. So how about earlier models, so old Keynesian models? And it turns out that there is a model by Metzler from 1941 that has all of the flavor that we want to analyze in this paper, except that it was only concentrated at inventories themselves, so as just the one variable and related to expected sales. So it turned out to be just a two-dimensional model. Now, that two-dimensional model was then put in a more formal way by Rhein and Franke in 1996, and it's a very elegant paper, but it still it neglects everything else, right? So it neglects employment, it neglects the labor market dynamics, it neglects what firms are doing with other parts of investment, such as you know borrowing from the banks to finance the expansion in capital. It only looks at how inventories react to expectations in sales. So as I like the strategy of concentrated in what you want to analyze, but at some point you expand. You say, okay, now I understood this piece of the problem, and these people understood the other piece of the problem, and then we put them together and see if it's more or less recognizable and understandable. So that's what we're going to try to do. It's build up on this model and a different strand in the literature coming from the Goodwin and Keen model and try to put them together. Okay? In heterodox economics, there's a more emphasis on inventories than on mainstream, but it's recognizably difficult to introduce them. All you have to do is read Marx's book, and by the time it gets to the chapter on inventories, the baggage of equations has grown to hundreds at that point, right, Mark? When you get to chapter 8. No, okay. okay, very good. So that's a joke, of course. What we want to do here is to see, you know, what is the bare bones model for fluctuations in inventory that take into account some of the stylized models that are around in a sort of manageable way. Okay, so that's the name of the game. So what do we do in this paper? We combine the Frank model with the Goodwin model. The Goodwin model, well, it's going to show up later, but it's a model for the dynamics of wage share and employment. Doesn't talk anything about inventories. It's assumed that output equals demand at all times. Whereas in the Frank model, it assumes that there is no change in the wage share. The wage share remains constant. So now you have something analyzed here with something else constant, something analyzed here with something else constant. We make the two constants interact and be non-constant anymore and combine the models. And it can also be seen as an extension of the Keane model with relaxing the condition that output equals demand at all times. And in particular, relaxing the, because you're doing that, you more or less automatically relax the condition of a constant capacity utilization and a constant capital to output ratio. Okay, so then the model becomes reasonably complicated. And then we look at the equilibrium for this complicated model, but not the stability, because I get tired very quickly of doing five-dimensional Jacobians. So then to look at the stability, we look at submodels. And some of the submodels, you might think, oh, but aren't you building up of submodels already? No, it's a different way of slicing the model, because we're going to be slicing it in timescales. So what I told you before, the Frank model is a model that doesn't have labor market dynamics. The Goodwin model is a model that doesn't have inventory dynamics, but they operate on similar timescales. So they're truly neglecting one of the variables that they should be paying attention. What we're going to do is have the combined model and then see if now you have all the variables there, but suppose that you don't consider what's going on for very fast fluctuations. Then you have a submodel. And conversely, you don't consider what's going on at the very long time horizon, then you have a different submodel. So it's a different way of generating the subclasses. Okay, so let's go to it. So here's for notation. So I try to be as standard as possible, but inevitably there'll be letters that you're going to forget what they mean. So by all means, at that point, just say, what was that again? So can you redefine? And then we come back. Hopefully I will remember. You don't have to remember. I have the obligation to remember. But the notation should be standard. But as I explained the notation, we already become familiar with the model. So we are going to assume that there is a constant capital to output ratio, nu. But that's not determining actual output, as in the Keane model. So in the Keane model, you have some amount of capital. You multiply by the capital to, or well, divide by the capital to output ratio, and you get the output. Here, what this gives you is just the potential output. So it means that you have enough machinery, you have enough technology to produce that if you want. The actual output is not given by that. The actual output is a decision by the firms. And the decision is they are going to produce Y, and it has two components. It's what they think they're going to sell, expected sales, and what they think they have to replenish inventory. So IP is planned investment in inventory. They're looking at the inventory levels. They open up the, you know, back room of the store, and inventory is going down, and they say, we need to replenish this a little bit. So that's a planned change in inventory. So that's output. And once the firms choose a level of output, you can divide that by what they could be producing, and that gives you the concept of capacity utilization. So normally this is less than one if there's spare capacity. Very few models deal with overcapacity issues because generally you already invested in capital enough that most firms are in capacity utilization less than one. But there's no constraint in the model. It has to be less than one. But just by, you know, you're going to see in many of the parameter ranges, this will turn out to be less than one. How capital accumulates, so remember, capital determines the potential output, so it's important to know how much capital is there in the firm sector. So capital accumulates by investment, but it's investment in capital, not investment in inventory. So the IK if you have a model without inventory, you have, you know, y equals c plus I plus g. That I is all of the investment. Now here I'm splitting the investment into different components. One is investment in capital, and that's what determines the growth of capital, but there's some depreciation. And again, normally you use a constant depreciation rate, but we put there as a function of utilization. This goes back to an old idea of Keynes, that if you are actually using capital at a higher rate, it depreciates faster. So it's some kind of, I think it was called user cost or a similar term. My discussants will set me straight later with everything that I said wrong. Okay, so that's on the supply side, so to speak, the production side. But then that's not what they're actually going to sell. What they're actually going to sell is demand. So they have an expectation of what sales are, but that might or might not be correct. And what they actually sell is consumption plus investment, because they sell to themselves, right, through investment. Okay. And the difference between what they make and what is demanded in for the whole economy gives you the change in inventory. So if they make more stuff than was bought, then inventories grow. If they make less stuff than what is bought, then inventories go down. So this is the thing that is absent from, say, the Goodwin and the Keynes model. The assumption is that whatever is produced is bought. So there's a strong assumption on demand in the marketplace. And in particular, that is satisfied by the households. So it's a model for firms, the Keynes and Goodwin model, and the households are meant to just pick up the slack. So if there's anything left over, they're gonna buy exactly what's left over. Not more, not less. Now you see, if you just substitute what this term is, IU, well, this is just the difference in inventories minus the planned investment in inventories, but the output is expected sales plus the planned investment in inventory, so that cancels out. And you see that the actual discrepancy between what they thought they were going to sell and what they sell, it goes into this unplanned changes in inventory. Okay, so I put that there because that should give you a hint of what the equilibrium will look like. At equilibrium, these terms will match. There will be no discrepancy. So that means that unplanned changes in inventory, in other words, surprises do not arise, but you still have the planned changes in inventory. It doesn't mean that inventory will not change at equilibrium. It will change by the amount that you thought it was going to change. That's the only difference. Okay. Therefore, total investment in the economy, the term that you're used to in a model without inventories, is not just investment in capital, but it's planned investment in inventory and unplanned investment in inventory. Okay? And do stop me. I think we have a lot of time, and every there's a, you know, stock flow consistency constraint. Every question that you ask gets added to the time that I have for the presentation, and there is less time for the questions afterwards.
Don't cheat.
Yeah. There are no sinks and sources in this presentation. Okay, so what about, so I need to put more meat in the model. So we are assuming that we're defining productivity as just an average productivity, so total output divided by the number of employed people that are needed to produce that output, so that's productivity. And then the assumption is that productivity grows at a constant rate. You can do different things, but we're not doing that in this paper. The employment rate is the number of employed people divided by the total labor force, and we are assuming that the labor force itself grows at a constant rate. So again, there might be a slowdown in growth of labor force in future. We have to write another model for that. Actually, I'm going to use a version of the model where both alpha and beta are zero. But you need to have a different model for the transition from a constant one to zero. But the zero one is not that difficult. Okay, then the wage rate is defined as, on average, how much each worker is receiving, because it's the total wage bill divided by the number of workers. Once you know what the wage rate is, you can calculate a very important concept for this kind of model that doesn't show up in necessarily models without inventories, which is the unit cost of production. So how much does it cost in terms of labor force to make each unit that you are of output? Well, that means it's the total wage bill divided by the number of things that are being produced. But then if you substitute what the wage bill is and what the total output is, so the wage bill is W times L, the output is A times L, the L cancels and you have just the wage rate divided by A. So that's the unit cost. And here's another interesting factor of a model with inventory. Normally, you say, when you say, oh, is this a nominal model or is a real model? And the difference between the nominal model and the real model is just multiplying by the price, right? You say, oh, how do I get real GDP? I get the nominal GDP and divide by some price index, and vice versa. If you tell me the real GDP, I multiply by price. Not quite with inventories, because you see, nominal GDP is whatever nominal demand is plus the actual cost of changes in inventories. But the cost of change in inventory is not accounted at the price because the inventory is not sold. The change in inventory changes because things are produced more than they are sold or produced less than they are sold. In any case, they are not accounted at price. The sales are accounted at the price. Inventory is accounted at cost. So what you see here is that whereas real output is C plus I plus the change in inventory, nominal output is not real output times the price. You have to multiply the sales by the price level, and you multiply change of inventory by the cost. That might seem like a trivial change, but if you just do it, for example, when you normalize the model, you normalize by what? By the nominal output or by a sort of a abstract variable, which is P times real output. And in this model, we decided to normalize by everything by P times output, even though that's not nominal output. So keep that in mind. P times Y is not nominal output. OK, very well. And now profits are defined in the standard way as nominal output minus whatever costs are there. And what are the costs? The labor costs, the cost of financing. So the firms have some debt to pay. And we're assuming the interest rate is constant. And then there's depreciation. Therefore, the change in debt for the firms, so why do they accumulate debt? And this is going to be the key variable. That's why it's a debt finance model, is given by whatever they want to invest. But now investment is a sum of investment in capital and investment in inventories. And notice that investment in inventories now includes both planned and unplanned investment in inventories. So if they're hit with a large amount of surprise in here, even if they didn't make plan to increase their debt, their debt's going to increase because they're going to have to pay in. Somehow they're going to have to pay the unplanned changes in inventory. Okay, so it's the total amount that they invest in nominal terms minus the profit that they have. And when you substitute what profit is, what you find is that it's investment, so not counted with depreciation, because depreciation enters both there and there, minus the pre-depreciation profit, so to speak. So it's the profit variable that you see in the Keene model. So it's output minus wages minus the cost of paying the debt. Okay. So that's the stock flow consistent model table for the model. And I let you work out that every row sums to zero and every column sums to a financial balance that is then redistributed into whatever each of the sectors can invest on. So the household sector only invests on deposits. The firm sector only invests on loans. But of course, there's the possibility that these two things are negative. So this is the net deposit position. And if they have a negative net deposit, it means that they're borrowing from the bank. And similarly here, this is the net loan position. It's just for ease of notation. And the way I can do that is because I'm assuming that the interest rate on loans and deposits is the same. If it was not the same, then of course the net position would be whatever you pay in interest in loans plus whatever you receive in interest in deposit. But here I can put the two together. Very well. So that's to satisfy the stock flow consistent police. Mark?
We have the chief policeman.
That's correct, yeah. so now, I can show you the what are the key behavioral assumptions that are made in the model. So far, I just gave you the sort of a general structure, but here's how the firms actually behave. So if there is a slide that you should pay attention, it's this one. So first, I define the variable of interest, and it's there's no name for that variable. It's not, you know, the expected sales share, or, you know, it's just pi e. So just call it pi e. Okay, I'm not going to be referring to it as anything else. It's just going to be pi. But well, you could call it expected profitability, but it's not quite so. Okay, so just call it pi. Why? Because that's the variable that turns out to be most convenient to use as the argument. You could find other variables, but then your equations would be uglier in the sense that, you know, they would have more terms and more dependence. Anyway, so how do I define pi? Is what they expect. The nominal value of expected sales, so YNE, minus what they pay in wages, minus what they pay in interest, divided by PY. But remember that PY is not nominal output, so I cannot say that this is the share of expected profits from nominal output. So it's that you are understanding now why I'm reluctant to give a name to this variable. But even less, even without a name, it has a formula because I can define each of these variables here. So this is truly expected sales divided by Y. So that's how it enters there. This is the wage share. Actually, it's not the wage share. It's the wage share of a putative nominal output, PY. But that's not the nominal output. But the point is that you can recover the actual variables from that. It's a simple algebra exercise. If I wanted to find the actual wage share, and you see what the actual wage share would be? It would be the wage bill divided by YN, where YN is price times demand plus cost times the change in inventory. I can do that calculation, but I don't do it there because this is a simpler variable to take to keep track of. Okay. So that's just to define the state variable. Now, here's the first behavioral rule. So it says that firms adjust their expectation based on two views, so to speak. There is the view of the future. So this is, at the long run, how they think that the economy is going to grow. So they have some function here, which is the expected growth of the economy as a whole. And if they have a view of how the economy grows and they think that, you know, eventually all the mistakes are going to be corrected, that's how the expectations, the expected sales are going to be growing as well. And there's a function of U, and it's a function of this pi E. What is U again? Is the capacity utilization. So this is the long-term view of growth in expected sales. But that gets corrected instantaneously by what is actually sold, what is demand. So you see here that, you know, if instantaneously the demand observed in the market is higher than your expected sales, then you're going to update expected sales up. You're going to say, okay, I have my view of the future, but for now, I'm going to adjust what expected sales is a little bit up. And similarly, if demand drops, you're not going to ignore the fact that demand is dropping. You're not going to, you know, close your eyes to the immediate reality. You adjust your expectations down. But you do that together with some term that maintains a firm eye on what's going on in the, for the distant future. Okay? So again, keep in mind this idea of two timescales. Very well. So this is for expected sales. Now, the second behavior assumption is that firms want to maintain, on average, a constant fraction of expected sales as inventory. So if I think that I'm going to sell 1,000 units, I want to keep, say, 100 units in inventory. And that's my constant fraction. And if it goes down, now it's because, you know, sales are more than what I thought, and I need to adjust this. I need to build up more inventory. And if it goes up, it's because sales are less than what I thought, and I shouldn't do anything. I shouldn't invest in inventory. So that is reflected in the next equation. So to maintain a constant level of inventory, but constant as a fraction of expected sales. But notice that expected sales are growing as well. So you're always going to have to be investing in inventory, because if your expected sales are growing and you want to maintain a constant proportion of a growing quantity, that has to grow as well. And it has to grow at the same rate. in the long term. So in the long term, these two things are equal because there are no surprises, and both Y and the desired inventory are growing at the same rate. So this is this term. But then again, there is an adjustment here, and the adjustment picks up a signal not directly from the mismatch in demand and supply, but from what you observe in your warehouse. So now inventories are, you know, going up and up and up. You have no space on the shelf to put anything else. Then you put this term down, right? So if your that's right. If V is much higher than the desired level of inventory, this is negative, and it pushes the investment in inventory down. Okay? So that's the bit that sort of adds to the Keene model, so to speak, because it's a mechanism for adjusting both inventory levels and expected sales. And this is the regular Keene model assumption, if you've been a student of the Keene model, that investment in capital, not in inventory, is a function of profitability, loosely speaking, because of this variable pi, pi I, see, I'm turning French already, and U, the capacity utilization, okay? And this also addresses a problem in the Keene model, which doesn't match, for example, with the observed reality for the past few years, for example, in the United States, where firms have an enormous amount of profit and nevertheless are not investing. So how do you do that if you say that investment is an increase in function of profit? Because what happens is that they have a lot of spare capacity. So if the capacity utilization here is very low, then you're not going to be investing a lot. So this is an increase in function of both profits and capacity utilization. Okay? Good. So that was what firms are doing. And here's the cute thing about the model. If this was the Keene model, that was it. You only have to determine the behavior of the firms. And the households are a residual variable. They have to do whatever the model tells them to do in terms of, because there's Y, and Y is total production, and consumption plus investment needs to add up to Y, and there's no other variable to take the difference, so consumption must be Y minus investment. And since investment determines K, K determines Y through the capital to output ratio, then investment determines consumption. So in other words, the people in a boardroom of Trump Tower, they decide how to invest, and all of you just see, you're investing that much, so I'm going to consume this much. Okay, so it's not quite how it should go. What you should have is that the people in Trump Tower don't talk to you to tell you how much to consume. You make your independent decision on how much to consume. They might advertise to you for eating Trump steaks, but you might decide to accept the advertisement or not. So in other words, there's an independent function, theta, that doesn't talk to the investment function, and it doesn't even take profits as an argument. The argument for theta is something that is in your interest, which is the wages and the level of wealth that households have. Okay, but the level of wealth of households, because of the closure of the model here, is the minus what the banks have, what the firms have in the bank, because we are assuming that banks have constant net worth. So they pass all the profits to the households. And if you are assuming constant net worth, you might as well assume zero net worth. And now you raise your eyes. Well, so why is zero so special? Well, it's just that it makes the math simple, but you could have it with any other constant, and it would always add that constant everywhere else in the model. But because you don't want to see that constant all along, then you just assume that it's zero. That means that the deposits of the firms are minus the debt of the households and vice versa. Anyways, point here is that this type of consumption function is flexible enough to accommodate a variety of specifications of consumption, as a fraction of income, as a fraction of interest income, as a fraction of wealth, and so on and so forth. So you just need to adjust this constant in any way you like, and you know, one way that I like to do that is just that it becomes a constant times the total wage bill plus a constant times D. Okay? And again, D is the net debt of the firms, which becomes the net wealth of the households in this model. So this means a function, a fraction of income plus a fraction of wealth. Okay, but now that you know consumption and you knew investment from the previous slide, you add consumption to investment and you know demand. So demand becomes a variable for the model, but it's not an extra variable. You see, from the point of this calculation is to tell you that the variables that you need to keep track of are omega, the wage share, D, the debt ratio, U, the utilization, and pi I so far. The four variables that you need to keep track. And if you know all of them, you put them into the respective formulas, and then you come out with demand. So YD is not a new state variable of the model. No questions? Everything is making sense so far? So what have we done? We've done the behavior of the banks, the firms. We've done the behavior of the households and the banks. So we are more or less done in terms of individual sector behavior, but there is one more assumption that we need to make, which is how prices adjust. So one possibility when there is a mismatch between supply and demand, it's going to be a mismatch in real terms. It's going to be, you know, more or less actual things being produced, but you can make them in equilibrium. You can make them match by adjusting the price. So namely, you know, either the price goes up if there's more demand than supply, or the price goes down if there's less demand than supply. But we don't. So this would be, we were just talking over lunch, one model that does that is a early, very pioneering model by Scott in the 80s, where it's exactly that mechanism. There's no inventories. But how does it equilibrate consumption with investment so that there's demand equals supply is by prices. Now, that would necessarily mean that prices fluctuate a lot all the time. You know, sometimes demand is higher than the supply, then the price goes up. Sometimes demand is lower than the supply, then the price goes down. Well, that's not actually what we see. You know, you don't go to Franprix and you see the price of something just going up and down every day because more people came to the store or less people came to the store. The example of Franprix is relevant because that's exactly what we're talking about. Why is it that they can maintain a more or less constant price that just adjusts, you know, from time to time because of some general inflation in the overall cost level, because they have stuff on the shelves, because they have inventory. So it doesn't matter if, you know, not enough people walked into the store and bought all of their bottles of wine, because they have where to leave their bottles of wine. They have the shelves. They can maintain the inventory. And conversely, if one day a lot more people came in than they thought, well, that depletes the inventory a little bit, and then they make a phone call to their suppliers, and then they replenish the inventory. So the adjustment mechanism is not through instantaneous clearing of the market. No business instantaneously clear markets, except Uber, with the price surge. Uber, for you French people. Okay? Yes, exactly. But we're talking about, you know, a more old-fashioned business where they actually, that's the point of maintaining inventory, is that you can have a more or less stable price and adjust your prices, you know, at leisure. And how do you adjust your prices? Well, from time to time you see if the profits that you're making give you enough markup on the actual cost that you're paying. And if they don't, then you raise a little bit of the price. And if they do, and you can still make enough markup to build Trump Tower, you lower the price a little bit because you say, okay, I don't really need that much. So that's the adjustment in price that happens. Okay, except, so this would be a purely markup adjustment, but we are also allowing for the possibilities that prices adjust to supply and demand as well, but not instantaneously. So if you see a lot of more demand than supply for a persistent amount of time, then eventually your prices will go up and vice versa. Okay, so they're the two components of the price adjustment. But the point is that the key word here is sluggish. The prices adjust in a sluggish manner. It takes some time. And the time is measured by these parameters, the relaxation parameters in that equation. Okay. Oh, and then there's how wage bargaining occurs. So that's a traditional sort of a Phillips curve argument that if employment is high, then the bargaining power of workers is high, so they bargain for more wages. And if employment is low, then there's an army of
reserve
army of unemployed, so they need to take a wage cut. They accept some wage cut, except that we are putting a little bit of an adjustment to the Phillips curve to the level of inflation, so that, you know, in addition to bargaining in real terms, they see what the inflation is and they add a little bit to the increase in salary to compensate for inflation. So if this parameter here is exactly equal to one, it means that there's a one-to-one compensation in the salary to inflation. So it means that it's almost as if you were bargaining in real terms. So the parameter gamma measures what's called money illusion. So if gamma is far away from one, it's because you don't quite have a grasp of inflation when you're doing the wage bargaining. But if it's exactly equal to one, you're a very good union, you know exactly what inflation is, and not only that, you have the power to transfer inflation into the salaries. Okay, and then we're done, and then we put it all together and you have a model. So we're not going to be deriving equation by equation, but that's an exercise in calculus, not even in differential equations because it's just one by one. So you do a very elaborate exercise with the chain rule, if you remember the chain rule. One of my colleagues at McMaster says that he can teach the chain rule in his sleep. Well, he can also teach the chain rule in everybody else's sleep. That's the point. And I noticed that nobody's sleeping here, so that's good. Anyways, so the model becomes a five-dimensional model. And the, you know, just to count the complexity here, if you eliminate those two, that's the King model, so to speak. So it's, and if you eliminate that, that's the Goodwin model. So if you do just wages and employment, and then we need to see how to adjust everything else, but if you just have a model for wages and employment, that's a version of the Goodwin model. If you then add private debt of the firms, then that's a version of the King model, one way or another. If you eliminate all those three and you only have the view of expected sales and utilization, notice that inventories are not there, because inventory is a secondary variable. Once you know expected sales and utilization, you derive what inventory is. Well, that's the Frank model that I told you, which is itself a formal version of the Metzler model. So this is the unification that I was telling you about. So you have a five-dimensional model that includes three subcases, so to speak. Okay. And the rate of inflation that enters in many of those equations is just given by this, because that was our assumption for the price change. There's the cost push in the price change, and there's the inventory push in the price change. And the growth rate of the economy is itself a very complicated function of everything else. And you see that in particular, it takes into account the expected growth. That's what enters the expected sales, but it takes into account all sorts of other relationships, so all sorts of feedback mechanisms, and some are positive feedback, some are negative feedback. So now you need to carefully analyze what are the channels that each of these things relate to each other. So we are not going to do that for the entire model. As I said, we're going to do that for subclasses of the model. But before we do that, we can talk about equilibrium. So just looking at those equations, you know, suppose that you haven't done this. Not these guys. They started this for the whole month. Exactly. But suppose you haven't done, and you're just given this equation in your exam, and this system of equations, and you say, find the equilibrium. Where would you start? Oh, come on, let's play this game.
There are people in option A, right? They have to do this game.
So for the option B people, you look at those five equations. So, okay, let's go more, you know, intuitively. What is an equilibrium in this type of model? So what's the notion here? The notion of equilibrium is a steady state equilibrium. So what is a steady state? It's a point where, so all those equations, and maybe I should have backtracked even a little bit more. So what is each equation telling you there? What is dot anyways? What's omega dot? It's the change. Okay, good. So the right-hand side of each of those equations tells you the rate of change of those variables. And the right, so you have the rate of change, and that's determined by the right-hand side. So what is a steady state? everything has got to be zero somehow. Okay, so now we're making progress. So now you look again at those equations and you tell me, where would you start if you had to make those things equal to zero? Lambda, that's very good. Who said that? Yes. Why? Because it's the one that has fewer things. Because the one that has fewer stuff, right? So you start exactly from lambda, because lambda will tell you that whatever the combination of all the other variables you have there, whatever they're doing, if you are to be in equilibrium, that g function has got to equal alpha plus beta. So that's progress. So we know what the growth rate at equilibrium is. So now we use that equation. Then where do you go? So now you know what's g of the big string. Now look for another equation that you can put the g and deduce something else. Not quite, because the g doesn't enter the omega equation. Ye, very good. Why? Because you put that here, it's alpha plus beta. And then what? Then you know that whatever happens, these two things have got to be equal. Because otherwise, this is never going to be zero. Okay? So you make this guy equal to that. So yd equals to ye. And then you're left with, so that's zero. And then you're left with the fact that this now needs to be zero. And this is what you already knew, alpha plus beta. So it means that this has got to be zero. Now we're making very good progress. And now you use the fact that g is alpha plus beta, ge is alpha plus beta, and that yd is equal to ye, and you go back to the equation for yd, and you determine yd. So that, let me just do that. So this is what I do. So the second equation tells you what alpha plus beta is for g. Then put that back into the fourth equation, the equation for ye, you know ge. Then put that back into the definition of g itself, which was that complicated function. Remember, it has a bunch of things, but now I know this is alpha plus beta, and I know what yd is equal to ye, and then I know this is alpha plus beta, so that tells me what yd is in terms of a bunch of the other constants. So then I find yd, but if I know yd, I know ye, because I already told you that they have to be equal. And in particular, you find that they don't have to be one. And one would be if expected sales equals output. But I already told you that everything is growing, including the inventory. So the planned investment of inventory is always a part of output. So expected sales is going to be slightly less than output, because output is going to have expected sales plus the planned change in inventory. So that's why the fraction of expected sales is going to be slightly less than one. Okay. Then you can tell what the expected, planned level of inventories is. So that's the desired level of inventory. And when you put it back in the definition of inflation, in particular, inflation depended on this term that has to do with the wage share and this term that had to do with demand and expected sales. But that is zero at equilibrium. So your inflation only depends on wage share. So at equilibrium, there's no mismatch of demand and supply, so there's no inventory push in the price level. Okay? And then you go to, yes?
Sorry, but the equilibrium level of inventory is independent from the interest rate and the cost of inventory. I mean, it's only defined in real terms.
That's right. That's correct. No, it's the number of units that you want to have in the inventory is a fraction of the number of units that you want to sell. So that's an assumption in the model. And it was one of the behavioral assumptions. So you could modify it and make a more complicated model where this doesn't hold. And then you're going to have some complicated function here, as you're proposing, a difference between the raw material cost and the price that you might eventually sell this thing. So you could have. And that would just complicate the model. So then you go to the remaining equations for the model. We already used many of them, but we go then to this equation and that equation. And the point is that you cannot solve them separately, because now you know g, now you know y, and so you know this part, and this depends on omega, and now you have there, you know, you still don't know phi. Sorry, what am I doing? No, it's that's right. From the equation for the debt, you get something that has to do with omega, and then you can plug it back here in the last equation, and you also have something that has to do with omega because pi depends on omega. And now you have two equations that need to be satisfied simultaneously, so you have a system. So you have to solve those two equations. It's not like the other ones that you got one by one. So now you solve those two equations. So in the solution to those two equations give you omega and d. And now once you know omega and d, you plug it back in the equation for u, and you have the utilization at equilibrium. And then once you know everything else, so now you know everything for all the four remaining equations, then you go back to the first equation, the equation for omega, and that's the last one that you look at, because that's the one that will give you the equilibrium employment rate. And if you look back at the system, you knew that that was going to be the last thing that you have to do, because it's the only thing that doesn't depend on anything else. Once everything is determined, then you know the equilibrium employment rate. So that's it. That's the interior equilibrium. It doesn't need to be unique, because the solution to these two equations doesn't need to be unique, because they're nonlinear equations. They can intercept in more than one point. But whatever they are not in the boundaries of the phase space. So that's why it's an interior equilibrium. Fine. So how long do I have? Negative 5 minutes.
Yes.
Okay, so I'll go 5 minutes or a little bit more. So this is to show you how to obtain the Goodwin model. So to obtain the Goodwin model, basically you just declare that demand has to be equal to production, and everything is in real terms, so there's no inflation. So many things get sent to zero in the model, and you only end up with two equations. So that's the Goodwin model. How do you do, and in particular, this is important. You say that investment is equal to profit. So that's the key thing in the Goodwin model, that firms never invest more than they make in profit or less than they make in profit. So that means that their debt level never changes. And that's why there's no D dot in this equation. And there's no Y, E dot and U dot, because everything was assumed to be constant to begin with. So then you end up with those two equations. How do you get the Frank model? Is the one that doesn't have employment? Well, by assuming that the wage share is constant, so there's no omega dot. And then the equation for employment becomes separate from the system, so you solve that separately, so it drops out. And then there's also no debt. But the investment function is given by something that has to do with utilization. So then you end up with the two last equations in the models, the equation for YE and the equation for U. Good, so those are the, and now how do you get the Keene model? Is by having a more flexible investment function that now depends on profit, but doesn't depend on utilization. How do you get the Keene model with inflation? By allowing inflation is exactly this model. So all those submodels are part of what we're doing here. So that was just to sort of make a consistency check. And then we go to our two subclasses of model for the original model, which are obtaining the separation of timescales. So for one of them is the long-run dynamics. I'm going to assume that there's no impact of short-term fluctuations. It's not that fluctuations are not there. They will be there, so I'm not neglecting the mismatch of supply and demand. I'm just saying that the decisions for the firms are not going to be influenced by that. So in other words, the firms are very long-term oriented. They're very stubborn. They are the opposite of myopic, right? You have myopic firms. They only look at what's going on now. These are far-sighted firms, right? They don't look at anything that is going on in the immediate short term. So it means that all the eta's and the anything that has to do with fluctuations is set to zero. So it means that the long-term rate of growth in the economy has to be equal to the expected growth. And then you're left with, only essentially four equations, because the equation for expected sales is independent. It drops out. Once all those things are zero, then you have that output is equal to expected sales. It doesn't mean that expected sales will be equal to demand, so there's still going to be some inventory, but you're not going to care about it. You can let your inventory go as high as you want or as low as you want. There's no desired level of inventories. okay, that FD was set to zero, so there's no planned level of inventories. So in a sense, this is the king model when you just let the mismatch be accommodated by a purely buffer variable. And that buffer variable doesn't feed back into the system. It just takes whatever the difference between supply and demand is. Okay. You can make, so that's the king model with inventory, so to speak. Okay. So we do that from both with prices and without prices. I'll skip the details. The point is that it has the same sort of long-term behavior as in the king model. There's a good equilibrium, and there's an equilibrium where that explodes to infinity. And then to conclude, I think I'll go to the short-run dynamics. Now, the short-run dynamics is the opposite. It's suppose that firms are entirely myopic. So all that they care about are the short-term fluctuations. So they have no long-term view. And in particular, if they have no long-term view, you set the long-term view to zero. I already mentioned that before, that if something is irrelevant and constant, my favorite constant in the whole wide world is zero. So that's why alpha is put to zero there, no productivity growth, no population growth. You could have it with non-zero constants there, but that would just complicate. Complexity of the model would remain the same. So it's a no-growth model, so which in particular would be good if you're doing some sort of resource-constrained ecological type of model where eventually there's going to be no growth. If that's the case, then there's no reason to increase capital more than just to replace capital. So investment is just the depreciation. And then you have, what comes out as the inventory level and the growth rate is a much smaller expression, much simpler expression, and the system reduces to this. Okay, now you look at that system, and it's not that reduced. It still has five dimensions. So we want to play a further trick here. So now this is a purely algebraic trick. So you could stop the story there and analyze that system. It's still five-dimensional. But now we play a further trick, which is to, in addition to not look at the long-term growth, also say that prices now, they only react to inventories themselves. So there's no cost push into the price. Because the cost is, morally speaking, also a long-term variable. So if you really wanted to see the effect only of the mismatch in supply and demand, then the cost function in the price is kind of an anomaly. So that's what we do. We set that function to zero as well. And since we're doing that, why not set the Phillips curve to zero too? So in the sense, you're not looking at the long-term bargaining position of the workers. This is really a model for what's going on right now, assuming that wages are fixed. And if wages are fixed, then there is no cost push for the prices. And then you can concentrate only on the inventory push. So now we're zooming into a situation where you ignore everything else except the fact that sometimes your inventories are going low and your inventories are going high. Okay, so you see the trick that is being played here. And if that's so, and you further assume that depreciation is a linear constant, linear function of utilization, then something magical happens, that demand becomes a proportional to the wage share, so you can collapse the equation for the wage share, you can take that out, and if you take the equation for the wage share out, then you take out the equation for employment and you take out the equation for the debt. And all that you're left is two equations, one for expected sales and one for demand. But that's the key that you want to concentrate on, is exactly just the mismatch between expected sales and demand. Okay, so now it's a two-dimensional system, so we know a lot about two-dimensional systems. So for this one in particular, we can show that there are three equilibria. So 1-1 is when supply equals demand. Okay, so the expected sales equals your demand. 0-0 is when everybody goes, the whole economy goes to zero, it collapses, so there's no production, no sales, and no demand. And plus infinity is when there's a sort of ultra-inflationary economy where expected sales go up and that pushes up demand because don't quite remember what's the mechanism to push up demand, but it's the is the wage, because now here the only thing that is happening is that, you know, they get a lot of income, so that pushes up demand and that pushes up expected sales with it. So everything, so it's kind of a ultra inflationary spiral. Okay, and then this is the kind of graph that you can show that, you know, the you look at all the isoclines for this two-dimensional system, and the arrows are supposed to indicate where things should move. So if you are below this line, it means that demand should decrease and expected sales should increase. If you're above that line, then demand should increase together with expected sales. So you see, they don't all go to a situation where they would converge to an equilibrium. So sometimes, you know, they diverge. So what happens is that if you stay sufficiently close to the 1-1, then you converge to that. This one is never stable, the 0-0 in this case. But you have many, many points where you would diverge to infinity, the plus infinity. And in particular, there is a separation, there's a bifurcation parameter that makes this equilibrium not locally stable anymore. And then now is the last thing I'm going to show is, suppose that I change a little bit my adjustment for prices. So remember that, what did I assume for prices here? So this is how inflation changes. So whenever demand exceeds expected sales, prices go up. And whenever demand is lower than expected sales, price go down. And then we got this situation that I just showed you. So recall what the situation is. There is the possibility of a stable equilibrium at 1-1, but you can move away from it and go, the 0-0 is never stable, and you can go to plus infinity and minus infinity. But that's because there's too much influence of the difference between demand and supply here. Now I'm going to make this influence one step removed. So this is what it's called information lags. So I'm not going to look exactly at the difference between demand and supply. That's not going to be my signal. The signal is going to be the inventory. So it's an intermediate step. When demand is higher than supply, the inventory will go down. Then I look at inventory and say, is it lower than what I want it to be? And then I put the price up. So it's a two-step process for updating prices. And then vice versa. If demand is lower, then the inventory go up. I look at inventory, there's more inventory than I want, then I put my prices down. Okay? And the effect of it is quite surprising. So this was the picture we had before. Now, by changing the price equation to something that looks at the desired level of inventory and inventory, you have the following picture. Then now the stable equilibrium at 1-1 disappears entirely. And the best thing that you can get is a cycle around it. And that's, then we looked at the literature. So who has done this kind of cycle that you know, never stabilizes because information is always chasing you, so to speak. You know, you raise the price because demand was low, but because you raise the price, so you raise the price because demand was high, but because you raise the price, that sends demand too low, and then it didn't match what supply is, and then you lower the price again, then demand became too high, and then it doesn't match supply, right? So you keep chasing each other, but that's because you're never looking at the last step in the mismatch of supply and demand. You're always looking one step removed. Well, that was documented by Kitchen in 1923. So we like that this is a Kitchen cycle model. Okay, so there's a model. There you go. So we thought too. So when we started, it's like, who on earth has done this? Well, it's very nice to quote in a 2016 paper, a paper by in 1923. So that's the end of the story. You have those cycles. You still have the possibility of things going to plus infinity. And now, interestingly, the 0-0, which is the total collapse in the system, becomes locally stable. So you can even start at a situation like this, sufficiently away from where the cycle would be, and you're going to be brought to total collapse. So that depends on which view you have on how prices are adjusting. Are they adjusting to the instantaneous mismatch of supply and demand, or they are doing it through a two-step process of looking at inventories? If you think that inventories play a larger role, then that's the situation. And I think the empirical evidence is more for this, as documented by Kitchen, than for the previous model. And that's the end. So that's what we did, and thank you.
So hello everyone. After we've been now shortly introduced, or rather extensively introduced to the model by Professor GRASSELLI himself, Severin and I will now have a look at it again. And in order to do so, we'll start first of all with the fundamentals of the model of Professor GRASSELLI, so to say the Goodwin and the Keene model. Afterwards, we'll generally introduce you the concept of stock flow consistency, as well as then the key features of GRASSELLI and Nguyen-Hu, so the model that we were just introduced to. Before we then will consider the general discussion in economic theory on inventories. And finally, of course, we will conclude and go towards some questions. So the Goodwin model was introduced in 1967 in Goodwin's paper, A Growth Cycle. In his paper, he develops a two-dimensional predator-prey system or model. A predator-prey model is something that comes from biology. So it's a biological concept in which you have an idea, a predator and a prey population. The predator population, for example, the wolves, and the prey population, rabbits. So you see both of each other depend on each other. So you can't have like a big population of wolves without any rabbits. And you can see that very nicely. So in Goodwin's model, we have the predator population, so to say, is the weight share, which we have denominated here in U. And we have the employment rate, which is our prey, denominated in V, with all the other parameters, such as, for example, labor productivity growth, as exogenous parameters. And you can see nicely the dependence of especially the predator on the prey population by looking at this one. So if V, the employment rate, goes to zero, we have a negative growth rate of U. So if you would then draw it in a chart with the populations on the y-axis and t, so time here, you would get two staggered sinus functions like this with the staggered mins and max. So it's not so nicely. So basically them following suit. And this is exactly the same what happens in Goodwin's model when you look at the growth cycle that then produces. So the trajectories of the weight share and the employment rate produce the so-called Goodwin cycle. If we, for example, start with a very high weight share, we'll have consequently lower investment. That's the idea. The lower investment influences the employment rate that then starts dropping. So we have a negative growth rate. The negative growth rate then causes also a falling weight share. So again, the idea of a staggered, so a sluggish adjustment of the weight share until the weight share is small enough that investment can pick up again, and then our employment starts rising again. Exactly the same logic applies if you start with a low wage share. You'll have high investment. High investment will cause high employment. And then, of course, rising wage share, fallen investment, and of course, the fallen employment. So you always get those trajectories and always the cycle. And we call that endogenous cycles because they produce automatically within the system. So if you apply this to the growth theory, So if you would apply this to the growth theory, you wouldn't get what we know from the neoclassical theory, like a constant growth that grows and grows and grows, but we would get cycles, so ups and downs within the growth. Thank you. So the problem with the Goodwin model is basically that he assumes, as Professor GRASSELLI already said, that output equals demand. That means all wages are consumed and that all profits are reinvested. So there are no inventories, and firms basically know exactly what they have to produce. So we always have full capacity utilization and a constant output to capacity ratio. So of course, if you really narrow it down, it's not really a demand-led model because output equals demand. So it's not very Keynesian if you really want to put it down. Furthermore, there's no feedback of income distribution on demand, and it's a non-monetary system without a financial sector. And in order to prove Goodwin cycles, there has been a couple of, empirical studies on it, for example, by Professor GRASSELLI in 2016, where he tried to show the Goodwin cycles for the OECD countries. Furthermore, there's a lot of literature on it with big discussions. Of course, there are extensions to the models, such as those of Professor GRASSELLI, and of course, other empirical tests. Papers we'd recommend looking at, if you're interested in, is for example, of Vinanciani and Mohun in 2006 and the others. We have a bibliography attached in the end, so if you're interested, just let us know and you can access it. Yeah. So the second model we'll now look at as a foundation is the Keene model that was published in 1995. And I know that I think 2/3 of you have been introduced to it again on Monday, so I'll try to keep it short. So Goodwin, Keane, as we all know, tried to model Minsky's financial instability hypothesis using Goodwin. And therefore, he adds a third dimension to the entire system. So by adding the debt ratio, he then gets a bad equilibrium. So where we have first kind of a moderation and then the entire system collapses, or we have a good equilibrium where we have everything is nice. So a stable employment rate, a stable wage share, steady growth, and of course, low debt. The problem with the Keane model is that, of course, it includes the financial sector. However, it still does not address especially the problem of effective demand and also of income distribution. Yeah, and especially Keane developed then a couple of new models basing on his 1995 paper and model, as especially Professor Lavoie's book of Stock Flow Consistency became more and more popular. So following that up, you can find a couple of new things that especially emphasize the stock flow consistency of the Keane model. It's yours.
Oh, okay. yeah, so again, this is kind of probably, for some people, this is maybe a bit redundant because we've heard about SFC modeling from Danny and also a bit at the start of the week with the, what's his name, Giraud. Gael, yeah, that's right. But yeah, basically SFC modeling historically comes from the works of Morris Copeland, who came up basically with the idea of the flow of funds accounts, which the basic idea here is that instead, that the difference, before that you had something called national income and product accounts, you still have that. So what you do there is you track what is produced and what income does that generate. What you don't look at is how are the things that are produced financed and what flows of money and assets and obligations do they give rise to. So that's what you do in the flow of funds accounts. So the idea here is that you want to show how all the flows in the economy are financed. Then we have James Tobin, who worked on models that are broadly similar to what we see today in the SFC. And that was too fast. so we have his Nobel acceptance speech, for example, where he stressed the central features which, in his opinion, every model must have, which includes things like that you have to track, that you have to track all stocks and flows through time, and that you have to be precise regarding the inclusion of time in your model, that you must have multiple assets and rates of return and so on. And one thing he also stressed very much was the use of adding up constraints as a sort of replacement framework for general equilibrium. So instead of general equilibrium, what constrains the model is that in the end, the accounting has to be consistent. And we saw that earlier in the table. I mean, the simplest example would be that if you have n economic units and you know the net lending position of n minus one of these economic units, then you automatically also know the net lending position of the nth unit. It can't be any different.
That is also what Marc Lavoie will underline in his Nobel speech.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and then we have, of course, the work of Wynne Godley, for example, in his textbook with Francis Cripps, and also in the paper where I forgot to put the year, the 1999 one, the Seven Unsustainable Processes paper. And yeah, again, the central features of these models are that you track everything, you track all stocks and flows, both tangible assets and financial assets, money, debt, and stocks have to feed back on flows, and you're very interested in modeling interactions between the real and the financial sector of an economy. So for now we've only talked about the accounting framework, but since most SFCs today are written by people who would describe themselves as post-Keynesians, the behavioral assumptions are usually broadly post-Keynesian, so effective demand typically plays a key role in driving the models. Furthermore, most SFCs that we see in the literature are written in discrete time, so that means what you do is you have little time subscripts next to your variables, and what you do is a flow is defined as the change in a stock over that period. That could be whatever you want the period to be in your model. It could be a quarter, a year, a week, also depending on if you want to make it empirical, what data you have. Whereas what we've seen today is a continuous time model, which I'll come to. Most of these discrete time SFCs are calibrated to a steady state and not solved analytically because they're usually way too big to do that. But we also see examples of continuous time SFC. So we've seen one today. So this is a model where the flows are defined as the instantaneous rate of change in a stock rather than the change over some predefined period. There are various examples of that within Matheus's own work beyond the paper that he was presenting today. We find many other examples also building on the Keen model, extending the Keen model. Maria Nicolaidi has a model where she has endogenous safety margins for banking. Sun Rayu has a paper where he looks at this debate between the paradox of debt and Minsky's financial instability hypothesis. So we can see that there is a literature like this. And we can also see that it tends to broadly focus on the issues of financial instability and sort of Minskyan ideas. That tends to be a very prominent topic. Depending on how complex these continuous time models are, they are either solved analytically or they can be simulated to study their properties. The key features of the model we've seen today is, well, that's we've kind of heard most of this. There's an independently specified consumption function. Investment function is based on capacity utilization, and yes, I do use the term expected profitability, even though it apparently it's wrong. But so let's say a proxy of expected profitability, rather than actual profits as you would have in the Goodwin model. That means that. All these assumptions mean that demand can differ from supply, which is based on sales expectations, and therefore the model also features inventories and models their adjustment. And we can have different specifications on how. We also have price dynamics. The debt dynamics are essentially the same as we have in Keen, or the only difference being that investment is no longer just capital investment, but also investment in inventories. So, as Matheus has said, this is a model which really brings together many of the different extensions to the Keen to the original Goodwin model, which have been proposed in the literature. In SFC models, the presence of inventories is pretty standard. As Matheus has mentioned, Mark in his book devotes a whole chapter to inventories and how especially how you include inventories in your accounting, what is the best way to account for their cost, how do you calculate the historical cost of your inventories. That's a big issue in that chapter, and they devote a lot of space to it in that book. And then they also include it in some of their more advanced models in that book. But more generally, most larger scale SFCs have inventories, because otherwise we would either have to suppose, as Goodwin does, that Say's law holds, or we would have to suppose, if we want a demand-driven model, that output always instantaneously adjusts to demand, or we would need some sort of price adjustment mechanism, as you mentioned, as Peter Scott has done. Yeah, but you know. If you think back to like your basic macro classes in first year or something, if you think about the idea of inventories, you might think that actually inventories should be something that stabilizes the economy, right? It's what reconciles demand and supply in sort of short run basic Keynesian macro, and you know the Keynesian cross of Samuelson. You have if demand exceeds income, then inventories go down, and therefore firms reduce their output, and you go back to the equilibrium point. And and vice versa if output is greater than demand. So in these sorts of very simple static models, you might think that it's pretty straightforward that inventories should be a stabilizing influence on the economy, right? Next. As Matheus has mentioned, it might not be as simple as that. He's mentioned the Kitchen 1923 paper, which is an empirical paper, which tries to discern what Kitchen calls minor cycles in UK and US output prices and interest rates. So these are cycles that occur over a time span of roughly 40 months. That caused a bit of a puzzle and a debate about what these cycles could, where these cycles could come from. And one of the hypotheses was exactly what we heard today, that it's about the interaction between informational time lags, about mismatches between demand and supply, and the adjustment speeds of output and inventories. And then there was the first sort of formal model that did this was the Metzler model, which we also heard about. And that's a model where basically if you assume an initial supply-demand disequilibrium, and depending on what you assume about how capitalists adjust to this equilibrium, you can get cycles of different lengths and different shapes. Then next. Then there was, again, we've heard about the model by Rainer Franke, and there's also another one he's done with Thomas Lux, where he puts this stuff in a growth model and shows that in a very simple growth model, inventory adjustment can actually produce a persistent cycle, so cycles that don't peter out at some point and go away. There's a bigger model by Chiarella, Flaschl, and Franke, which is basically a book-length type thing, where they also add a bunch of different features to a continuous time growth model. So they have inventories as well. They have the sort of employment distribution nexus from Goodwin, and they have a sort of old Keynesian interest rate determination, where the interest rate is determined on money markets. But in general, when we look at this sort of literature, we can say that at least in the long run, in growth models, the presence of inventories may no longer be a stabilizing force, but rather whether you get cycles and what these cycles look like and whether the equilibria you get are stable very much depends on what you assume about how producers react to mismatches and how quick they react. And this is exactly what they find in the paper we've just heard as well. In the long run version, in the Keane version, that there is, if you include price dynamics, which is interesting, that there's a debt deflation equilibrium, which you can't have in the original Keane model because it doesn't have prices, so it can't have deflation. But that's kind of cool because that was sort of one of the central ideas of Minsky.
After you've heard now a lot on inventories, to put it all in a nutshell, the model finds that it is important, or it emphasizes the importance of inventories, as they can produce their own cycles, as we've seen now a couple of times, and also that there are other papers on that. And of course, they can cause instability and consequently influence the growth cycle. So inventories are not to neglect in generally in the economic theory. Professor GRASSELLI, succeeds in actually removing the most shortcomings of Goodwin's and Keane's models. However, we have, of course, those extensive mathematical formulas. So there's not really, or it's at the expense of the analytical tractability to a certain extent. And of course, we have some questions to you. I'll present the first two, and then Severin will take the other ones. So first of all, what are the advantages and the drawbacks of continuous time compared to discrete time and stock flow consistency?
So it's like the democratic primary debate. I got the questions in advance.
Well, then we expect a really good answer, though. Yeah. And the second one would be, what would happen to the dynamics described in section 5 of your paper if you would add depreciation of inventories? You have depreciation of capital in there, but what would happen if inventories would depreciate? Because that is usual in the normal world or in the regular world, but it's not really often emphasized within models.
Yeah, this is a bit of a bigger question, and that kind of it only marginally relates to what you presented today, and it more relates to your empirical work on Goodwin cycles. Maybe you've seen that there was, I think it only came out a couple of months ago in the CJE, there's a paper by Stockhammer and Mitchell, where they basically, the basic point they're making is that they construct a simple three-dimensional Minsky model, and they note that even though you don't have the typical Goodwin mechanism in there, you have a weight share, but the weight share doesn't actually feed back on growth at all. Uh-huh. Huh? So it's essentially it's a two-dimensional system in output and financial fragility with a weight share tacked onto it. And if you solve that model, you also get a sort of Goodwin cycle, you get a counterclockwise cycle in employment weight share space. And the basic critique they're trying to make is that if you empirically note Goodwin cycles, that doesn't mean that they are actually produced by the mechanism that Goodwin had in mind. So my question would be, is there some way that empirical research can make sure that the cycles, if we do observe these cycles, that they are actually due to this mechanism? The second question is, at the end you talked for some time about the idea of price adjustment. Yeah? So in particular in the shorthand version of your model, and we have a course with Mark where he showed us the post-Keynesian theory of the firm, which usually post-Keynesians would assume that in the short run, prices are relatively fixed, right? So the eta Q parameter in your model would, from a post-Keynesian point of view, would be expected to be very, very close to zero, actually. And my question is basically just to what extent does your model, usually the fact that prices are fixed, and we can find that in Keynes as well, the idea that prices don't adjust instantaneously or very fast to any mismatches, Keynes himself considers a stabilizing factor. And my question would just be to what extent your model challenges that common view. And then, because this is a course that is on economic policy, the final question is whether there are any policy implications that you would want to emphasize from this work or from your work on your empirical work on Goodwin cycles. So, say, if we observe a Goodwin cycle empirically, what does that mean for policy? Right. Should we crush workers in order to keep investment high, or maybe not? From these types of models that you've done in general, what are some policy implications of that? And that is all. That's the bibliography. Yeah.
Okay. By the way, those of you who want to listen to Joe Mitchell can come to the symposium we organize on the 8th of December. There is even a free lunch. Not exactly free. So now you need to work again.
Yeah.
You need to answer all these questions. And now,
all these guys.
We can put them there, so that everybody can.
And then all these guys will have other questions for you.
Yeah. And I have questions for you. Yes, thank you. I think you capture a lot. You capture very well the features of the model, but you had some time to look at it. So let's see. So let's go back to where are the questions? Yes. Yeah. So the first one is a methodological question. So continuous time versus discrete time. So as we were talking over lunch, I think one of the main drawbacks of discrete time is if you have models that depend strongly on the choice of the time period, right? Because then you have to have a good story of why that time period is relevant for whatever, you know, type of firms or type of consumers or type of government. And maybe there is a story. For example, I was just discussing with people at IFD recently, you know, taxes. Taxes are not paid. So some taxes are paid continuously. If people pay payroll taxes, they're taken out of their salary every time that they receive their salary. But even that is not continuous, is every time that they receive it. But in some cases, business pay taxes only once every 6 months when they have to reconcile. So they keep up some amount of money to pay their tax if the tax are not taken directly from sales, and then they have to reconcile the receipts with the taxes that they have to pay. So that's an argument for having some discontinuity built in to the model, even if you have continuous time processes for sales or for other things. So what I mean to say is that just taking a model in discrete time without considering the reason for the time period that you are adopting seems to be a bit arbitrary, and that's a drawback because you need to say why are you taking 1 day, why are you taking 1 month, why are you taking 3 months. And it's even more problematic if you have a model whose key conclusions, for example, there is some development of chaotic dynamics. Well, that's pretty strong, right? If you go and say this model has chaos, and then you see that it only has chaos if the time period is greater than a certain threshold. Well, then you need to put the conclusion of the model into question. So there are some people that say that as a methodological premise, if the conclusions of your model are not invariant with respect to the choice of the period that you are adopting, then you're not allowed to draw strong conclusions from a specific choice, unless you can justify that choice. Like, you know, nothing in the model really happens on a weekly time scale, and all that is relevant is a monthly time scale. But I think that's very difficult in practice to argue. Conversely, with the continuous time models, then you don't have to specify any relevant time scale because it's instantaneous, and so you have flexibility. But then, you know, the usual objection is that, well, but when you want to simulate, you have to discretize. But when you want to calibrate the data, you have to discretize. Yes, that's true. But discretizing is different from adopting a discrete time model, because you have flexibility in the discretization. If a discretization doesn't work, you change the discretization, right? If you have something that, you know, developed some instability because of a numerical glitch that has to do with the discretization, then you go and make a finer time scale that removes that. Or, you know, if the data that you are receiving is of a, you know, lower or higher frequency than the type of calibration that you adopted, then you change the time scale of the calibration. So that's the difference. If you start with a continuous time model, you're not attached to a particular time scale, and you can adjust to first what gives better numerical results, because in the numerical methods you're actually trying to simulate something. So simulate, if you introduce something that was not in the model just because of an artifact of the numerical technique, you don't want to see that. And on the calibration. Now, does that mean that there are no drawbacks to continuous time? No, that's not the case. For example, one thing that I struggle a lot whenever I have to do it in continuous time is issues of dependence on wealth. So there are many models when, you know, if you have a consumption decision today that depends on the wealth that you had in the previous period. That is exceedingly complicated to do in a continuous time model, because there's no such a thing as, you know, what is the previous time period. And you know, in discrete time, you can always say you had the expected wealth, and then when you go to the actual wealth, you just rebalance your portfolios given what your actual wealth is. That doesn't work at all in a continuous time. So you need a different type of a mechanism there. So it's not a simple translation. It's not the case that you can take every discrete time model and just have a simple continuous time version of it, so to speak. That you might have to make more choices. Believe me, we tried. We tried to get Mark's book, you know, chapter by chapter, and doing a continuous time version. And whenever there is a wealth consumption or a portfolio decision that depends somehow on your wealth on the previous period or your expectation of wealth in this current period, it breaks down. So you have to think harder. It doesn't mean that it's impossible, but you have to make additional modeling choices, so to speak. So that's my view on the continuous time and discrete time. What's the next question? Depreciation of inventories. Yes. It might change. We don't know. We haven't we haven't fully analyzed. The reason we didn't do is because, yes, as you mentioned, it's not commonly done in the literature, because it's the idea is that, as opposed to, because we're talking about something that is used for a really long term, right? So like you buy a computer, and why do you care that the computer depreciates? Because you're going to use it for 4 or 5 years, and then after 4 or 5 years, it's worth nothing because all the new software cannot run. Or like phones, right? To use a phone after 5 years is impossible. And other types of equipment you're going to keep for even longer, right? There are cranes that go there, and you use them for 30 or 40 years. Whereas inventories. Even models that assume that inventories are there, the the thought in the back of your mind is that they're not going to stay in the shelf for many, many years, right? So the bits of inventory that do don't depreciate that much, like wine. It's okay to have a wine that is five years old, but yeah, you're going to be selling your refrigerators and your TV screens and so on faster than the time scale where depreciation plays a role. And I think that it's the informal way to put that there is on the desired level of inventory. If you have a desired level of inventory that is very high, then you're never going to be consuming there's not going to be enough turnover in the inventory for depreciation not to play a role. But as long as that FD parameter, right, how much do you keep in inventory, and that's typically low. If you look at calibration that Blinder and other people did, it's they said, on a normal year, investment in inventory is 1% of GDP. So that gives you the order of magnitude of what is the inventory that you want to keep. It's a couple of more percentage points. So it's a low fraction, is 1/10 or 1/20 of what expected sales are. And because it's a low fraction, then now things have turnover and they're gonna be off the shelves. And then they might depreciate, but that's somebody else's problem. It's now, as they bought that as a piece of equipment to use for a long term, now that's part of their capital. And that depreciates as capital, but doesn't depreciate fast enough as inventory. But that's a tortuous way of saying we didn't do it. Okay? But the reason for not doing is that, right? It's the implicit assumption that they don't stay too long as inventory. And that's reflected in the accounting as well. This type of last in, first out, or first in, first out accounting. It's never the same item of inventory that is there. Some inventory is added, and then somebody comes and buys, and then they bought the one that was there in the shelf for the longer time. And so it's not exactly the same. So you need to say it was the last that came and the first that got out, and so on. But implicit in all of that is that there's a higher speed of turnover of inventory. Okay, you can disagree with the answers, and you can say no, that's not enough.
They also need to leave some room.
Right. Okay. The work of Joe Mitchell and Stockermeyer. So I haven't seen their work, but I have seen some other papers in recent years where people make similar points, that now we're seeing the same clockwise or anti-clockwise, depending on how you put the variables. I like my wage share down and the employment up, and then it becomes anti-clockwise. No, clockwise, whatever, yeah. And so if you see that, does it necessarily come from the Goodwin model? No, but it's the opposite question that you need to ask, right? It's always in this business, it's model rejection that you want to look at. It's not model acceptance. You never accept a model. You reject a model. But you can never have enough evidence to accept a model. So a model has not been rejected yet. That's the what you can tell from a model. You never say, you know, this model is right. You say, we don't yet have evidence that this model is wrong. And so what they're saying is that, you know, there are more models that could be right based on this piece of evidence. And then you look for more empirical evidence to rule out some of the other models. So maybe, you know, you're never going to distinguish between a Goodwin model and one that produces the exact same type of cycle. But that's because you're not looking at enough or now you need to look at other dimensions. So if you now include debt in this model and include debt in the other model, how does it behave? Are they still indistinguishable? Well, if they are, then that's fine. You proceed, you keep going. So you try to look at other conclusions of the model and extensions of the model, and eventually you're going to have some dividing criteria that it's going to separate. So the point of the, you know, that's why we spend so much time with redoing the work of Harvey for the Goodwin model, is that Harvey and the papers that use Harvey thought that they had rejected the model. And we didn't think that that was the case. So we said, you know, the conclusion of our paper is that the Goodwin model cannot be rejected yet. It might be rejected for other reasons, but not for the reasons that they present in those papers. Solo has a phrase that he says, you know, God created more stories than differential equations. You know, the same differential equation can explain a bunch of things going on. So the same thing here, you know, because you have the same trajectory, so to speak, and the exact differential equations, they can come from many different assumptions. So you can write this, you know, suppose that what you want to do is to fit a predator-prey model to wage and employment cycles. That predator-prey model can come from a Goodwin specification. So that's one way of deriving that. But it can come from many other things. But the trajectories are going to be the same. So that's the same idea. God created many more models than trajectories. And many models can give you the same result. And that's fine. You know, you just look for more evidence to reject some of those models. There was a question there, yes. Oh, okay, good. Does your model challenge this conclusion? No, because I think it reinforces the conclusion, right? So in the model, whenever you see the, you know, instability of some of these points is because of the faster reaction times. And when it's not the fast reaction time, it's the difference between reaction time to different factors, to different effects, right? Remember, it's all about the etas, right? So it's the difference between the eta E and the eta D. So the eta E is how fast you adjust the expected sales, and the eta D is how fast you adjust the inventories. So there's a condition that if one is greater than the other or vice versa, then the equilibrium is unstable. Yeah, so that's reinforced in the model. But then, yeah, so how do they enter in the prices? Yeah, so if eta Q is zero, then we don't see any of those kitchen cycles or anything. But the point is that, you know, are they there in the data? So if they are there in the data, you want to have a model that at least, you know, is open to that possibility. And if you don't have that, so that's the only challenge, right? So a model that doesn't have that kind of short time scale adjustment to inventories will never see a cycle that depends on information provided by inventories. Almost by definition, right? if the only time scale in which you adjust the prices is related to changes in wages, then you're never going to see the kitchen cycles. Right, so you want to provide a theoretical mechanism to allow for the existence of the cycles that you see in the data. So I don't think that contradicts the post-Keynesian pricing theory. I mean, it's just it's a complement. Right? But Mark might disagree. Policy implications. So I don't think there's strong policy implications from the Goodwin model per se, because there are the cycles, and endogenous cycles are fine. Sometimes you're going to have higher wage share, sometimes you're going to have lower wage share. But so if the economy really satisfied the Goodwin model, I think we could go out and relax, have wine for the rest of the day or for the rest of our lives. The problem is that if you couple the Goodwin model with some of this more, so in a sense, there's nothing bad in the Goodwin model. The equilibrium in the Goodwin model is not bad, and you can tweak. You know, you can have a trade-off of inflation and employment and so on, but that's in the, sort of a old Keynesian fine-tuning, but everything is more or less fine. The problem is if you have a model like Keynes model or some others where there is really a sort of runaway equilibrium. So an equilibrium where wage share and employment doesn't just fluctuate around some more or less stable point, but it just goes to zero or goes to very low points. Well, no, that's a problem. Okay, and then the implication, the policy implication for that is that, well, you need to now prevent that from happening one way or another. So one way that we did that in one paper was by government spending. So government spending puts a floor into the profits going down. But there are many other ways of doing that. For example, debt relief would be another way. So Steve is very, adamant about the debt jubilee. So I know that... Devrim is working on a debt relief mechanism for the key model. So all those policy implications are good, but the key message is, I think, what Steve keeps saying, that private debt matters. It might not matter exactly in the way that he's been saying more recently, all this controversy about if debt should be added to the definition of aggregate demand or not. Some of you have been involved in the controversy. So it might not matter in the way that he's been saying more recently, but it clearly matters in the model, in the earlier versions of the model. And I think that's the implication, that you have to have a model that takes it seriously. For example, by having it as a possible variable that drives it to infinity and something else to zero. But if you don't put that in the model, then you're never going to see it. So that's the key policy implication, is one way or another, pay attention to the level of private debt. It might not be in the exact way that the model predicts, but now have another model that has that as a variable as well, right? And pay attention to the consequences. So the work I'm doing with Gael here is related to inequality. So now, it's private debt as something that, you see large discrepancies in inequality between a class of workers and a class of investors, if and only if the private debt is going to infinity. So it's kind of a signature of growing inequality is that you have this increase in debt. And so now it turns the conclusions of the Keynes model, well, not upside down, but it's like, suppose now that we do observe growing inequality and divergent inequality, as Piketty says that we are observing. Well, that's an indication that we are in the path of the bad equilibrium that the Keynes model predicts. So you should be paying attention to that. So, it's the signatures, that's what they do for you. You start seeing something and you say, well, I'm not completely sure that that's what's happening, but you have triggers. And, this should be saying, okay, let me pay attention to those variables because they are important. So that's the key policy implication. Be aware. So that's the conclusion. Be aware of private debt. And I think that was it, right?
That was it, yeah.
Yeah, good.
So it's not over yet. Now you have to face the questions of the students. Yeah. So I have to dash for 10 minutes. So don't forget to introduce yourself again for a speaker, but also for Mark, who takes some notes.
So my question is to one of the stylized facts that you mentioned at the beginning, that you have this both counter and pro-cyclical movement of inventories. Yeah. And I was wondering, like, what is the theoretical rationale behind it? Maybe you mentioned it somewhere, but since we looked more at the model, I would like to know what is like the logic behind it. And also how this, maybe it's something I didn't get, how this feeds into the model again. Like
right.
These short run, long run differences.
Yeah, that's right. So that was all in that. I don't have the slides there, but it's in the difference between the adjustment of the short term fluctuations and then the long term investment, right? So the how does it go? If Yeah, put the slides up. Yeah, you have to.
With the
there is no intuition, and that's where the neoclassical theory fails. They cannot provide an intuition. That's just a fact, and now you have to explain the fact, right? So the intuition that fails entirely, this sort of stabilizing production smoothing, will never fit any of that. So yes. So what we have there, so it's strongly counter-cyclical at high frequencies. So what we're talking about here is at an instantaneous drop in output. So what an instantaneous drop in output is going to do, it's going to push, if that parameter eta, if that adjustment parameter eta is large enough, it's going to push expected sales down. If it pushes expected sales down, then you see the desired level of inventory is a fraction of expected sales. So now what do we want to say here? That if it's let's see what we want to explain. So countercyclical means that the inventories are going up when sales go down. So why is that? So this is just the immediate reaction without taking into account any of the adjustments, right? So the why the demand goes down and there's not enough time for the expected sales to adjust. So, and not enough time for the level of inventories to adjust, so they just get hit by a large unexpected shock. Yes, okay. But then you have enough time to do this, for it to percolate into the system, right? So you have enough time, and it's a sluggish thing. So now sales go down, the desired level of inventory go down, and now you start to replenish the inventory. Because now the level of inventory is too low, and then you want to push it up. So now it becomes pro-cyclical again. Yeah. So I think the what's going on here is that it's not. You have both the instantaneous effect that doesn't have to do with any of the adjustments that the firms are doing, and that provides the counter-cyclical thing. And then you have the way the firms react to that, because it's sluggish, because it's not instantaneous. Right. If the reaction was instantaneous, then that would not happen. And because it's sluggish and works through this extended time periods, then you have the pro-cyclicality in the longer time frequency. Yes.
It's just a little. Can you just pass this? Thanks.
I think there were questions.
So it just was directly to what he just said.
Oh, okay.
You said the desired level of energy goes down, but couldn't it just stay constant? I mean, that's also possible because if you have like a high, like all of a sudden you have a high shock, like you have more unexpected inventories because you sail less.
Yes.
You can still stay at the same level of desired inventories and still turn.
Instantaneously is the same level, but then as you adjust the expected sales, that goes down, right?
Oh yeah. Okay. Then
because
yeah.
The desired
okay.
Level
then
is
makes
a
sense.
Fraction of expected sales.
Okay.
It's on the same field, so I'm sorry. Could you re-explain, please, how the fact to consider two time scales reduces the number of dimensions in your model?
No. If I only look at one time scale at a time, then that reduces the number of dimensions. If I look at the two time scales at the same time, then I have the full model. So the reduction in dimension is if... So I have this two reaction functions. If I set these two parameters to zero, then that means that I'm ignoring the short-term fluctuations. So I'm only looking at the long term. Okay, and then yes, then that. That's right. Set those things to zero. Now you have output equals to expected sales. So I don't have to consider the independent dynamics for expected sales. The expected sales will always be equal to one, right? The ratio of expected sales to output. So you have four dimensions there. And then how do you do a further reduction? Well, if you assume that you still need to specify what's the long-term growth. So there are two common assumptions for the long-term growth. One that is constant, and that would be the Frank model. But if you put this equals to a constant, then you see that this is going to disappear, and the employment rate is going to be constant. And then for the employment rate to be constant, it means that the initial one has got to be the equilibrium employment rate, because it enters that equation there, right? So if it's going to be a constant, it has got to be a very special constant. It's the constant that makes the wage share not to change as well. So our conclusion is that this is not robust. So assuming that the long-term growth in the expected sales is equal to a constant, alpha plus beta, only works in a very special choice of initial conditions. You never like that in dynamical models. So the alternative to that is to make it as the growth in capital. So in other words, you say that your long-term growth in expected sales equals the investment function, growth in capital, okay? And then if you do that, then the capacity utilization drops out, because now you are at the situation where the long-term expected sales, which is output, grows at the same rate as capital, so there is a constant capital to output ratio. So that's the sort of very close to the Keen model in the spirit. So that's how you recover the Keen model. You reduce one more dimension. You get rid of the capacity utilization. So this is for the long-run dynamics. For the short-run dynamics is when you only, so back to the behavior assumptions. So before we neglected those, now we are only going to do those. So I'm going to neglect this. So I'm going to set those growth rates to zero. And the effect of that is that I will still have the same number of dimensions in principle. Yes. So your question is very good, because it allows me to explain a little more. So maybe you remember, I went too fast here. I said, now if you do the short-term dynamics, you don't have any reduction per se. You don't have any reduction immediately, right? You still have a five-dimensional system. So now I need to assume something else. I need to, in addition, assume that prices only adjust to the short-term fluctuations. So also prices, so it's the opposite of you know, if say there are two forces for change in prices. One is the wage price, wage cost, and the other is the inventory and the demand and supply fluctuation. So you say that the tradition in post-Keynesian is to ignore inventory and only use the sort of very long-term changes in prices that only depend on wages. Okay, now because I'm only going to concentrate on the short-term dynamics, so that one I'm going to set to zero. And I'm going to say the prices only change because of instantaneous fluctuation in demand. So if I do that in addition to putting the growth rate to zero, with the long-term growth rate, then what you obtain is that your demand, you just substitute what it is because now many of those things are constant, you find that demand is just proportional to the wage share. But now if the demand is proportional to the wage share, then you know, you can have an equation for YD dot, which is the same equation as the omega dot. And that's the one that appears here because it's just the inflation term in there. It's this inflation term because we set this function to zero. And that's how we reduce the dimensionality. Because if you see, if now the point is that if, yes, I can separate these two systems. And once I solve for YE and YD, then I can recover the other variables as, so you see the point is that they don't, those variables don't, omega, lambda, and D are not variables in the equation for YD and YE. Whereas YE and YD are variables for the others. So I can solve the system for YE and YD first, and then put the solution back in the larger system. So in other words, I still have a five-dimensional system, but I solve for two variables first. It separates. I can solve for two variables and then solve for the remaining three variables. So if I can solve for the two variables first, I might as well just analyze the two variables before I do anything else for the other variables. And that's the kind of dynamics that we find here.
Hi, I'm Sukriti from option B2. I was wondering how come in the expected profitability, like the variable pi
yeah,
e,
yeah.
How come you've not included inventories in that?
Because
it's just the output minus...
No, they are included in the sense that... they are included, it's just that they're not put there. But YNE is P times YE plus C times IP, the planned change in inventory. Because if you're going to make what you expect, you're going to expect to sell YE, and your change in inventory is going to be IP. And then you substitute what this is, because now your Y is YE plus IP, so I can substitute the IP in there, and I can substitute what C is, because omega is C over A, and then I get that formula. So in a sense, that's why you have the 1 minus omega there. The 1 comes from this, and the minus omega comes from that. So the inventories are there. Yeah. But the expected inventories, because this is the expected profitability. That's very good. Some of you are paying close attention to the formula.
Okay, there were the two at the very end. Was it you? You were first,
huh? I was first. All right. My name is Yelena, option C1. Thank you for the presentation. And I would like to go back to the concept of inventories,
yeah.
And that is contracyclical.
Yeah.
So as you might know, there is like a big field that is called logistics nowadays. And the only thing what they do is basically they take either components or the finished products that they deliver it across the world.
Uh-huh.
So the purpose of this is to actually eliminate the inventories. And so this has two implications. First of all, it is cross-country. So like it's more difficult to capture exactly the inventories for one country and the other country.
Right.
And second of all, it's actually trying to eliminate the inventories.
Right.
So how does this fact affect your model?
I told you they are good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, so it's all based on the empirics. So far we still have data that shows the inventories are important components and so on. If 10 years from now everybody works like Zara, right? Zara doesn't keep any inventory in the and you know, the moment that you pick a shirt from Zara, it sends a signal instantaneously to the producer somewhere in Asia, and they start producing that shirt again because now you pick the shirt in here. So I guess that's what you're talking about, is this very integrated supply chain. I say good luck. Yes, if they can do that, and then we'll write another model once that happens. But so in a sense, you know, there will still be so essentially is that the desired level of inventory is zero. So you can still write a model like that, and it would be one of the versions that are showed here, where you only have unplanned changes in inventory. Because okay, you might want not to have inventories, but you might completely misread the signals of sales, and then inventories just accumulate. Right, and then what do you do with that? Even if you're Zara, you know, it accumulates inventory and you cannot force people to go and sell. So you might not have the planned component, but you still have the unplanned component. And then conversely, when then demand goes up again, you're going to be eating out that unplanned component until it gets back to zero again, right? So I think the model can accommodate that. It's one of the versions of the model. And if the data moves in that direction, then that's where the model should go.
Well, can I just add a small comment?
Sure.
This, I think it's called right on time, just in time delivery.
Yeah.
It's mostly used for automotive production, like for example, Fiat and other big car industries. So I think it's quite, like, it's worth probably considering in the model for the future. It might be a good insight.
Sure. But again, this is, it's not a sector by sector thing, right? So the view here is a model for the whole economy, and it might take some time for, you know, other parts of the economy to have this right on time thing. And well, the other thing is that it's been known since Blinder and the papers in the 1980s that even though the micro-founded literature was mostly for production, inventory in production, because that's what they think they understand well, you know, firms and investment and so on. The largest component of inventory is retail inventory, right? So even if you have, you know, the best right-on-time supply for, you know, when a company needs to produce a car, then they you know, send an order for an automotive part, and that comes instantaneously or very rare, you still have retail. And unless we move to a model where, you know, really all sales are online sales and so on. So look, if you have Grand Prix, you're going to have inventories because you walk into the store and you have shelves, right? So, huh? The retail, yeah.
You go to buy a car, there are cars in the parking lot that you can choose from.
Well, I actually recently experienced it in Italy.
My people.
So, I actually experienced it recently in Italy, and we went to the car dealer for Honda, and we wanted the car, and they said that there is a waiting list, so if you buy it now, you will receive it in 6 months.
Yeah.
So I think this is how, like, at least a lot of sectors work now, and probably this is something to think about.
It's true.
A lot of people will just go to the and buy a Toyota instead.
That's right.
Okay, so there was a question here.
Oh, me?
Yeah.
Microphone.
Okay. Thank you. I'm Martin from Option A. Well, it's in the same topic, a little different, but in the first part you say that for micro there's some evidence that companies take planned production in order to stabilize production.
Yes.
That would be in order to minimize the operational cost.
That's right.
On the other hand, we have a model where the inventories are targeted as a fixed portion of the sales.
Yes.
Which, if I don't understand wrong, it goes the other way. If you stabilize production, you have highly volatile inventories, and so okay, for both decisions, you have a trade-off between inventory cost and operational cost. So that was what I was asking before about the PE, because perhaps there, if you include not only real impact of inventories but also financial or cost.
I see. No, that's a good question. And my answer is the same. It would be a different model, but I can see now what where you're coming from. That maybe the and that goes back to Metzler, right? So that was the idea of Metzler and Franke. But maybe they were being destabilizing by sort of enforcing it to be a destabilizing factor because of being a constant fraction of expected sales. And what you're saying is that it should be that plus something that has to do with minimizing production costs over time. And if you put the two things together, okay, well, there might be some times when demand just fluctuates a lot and the destabilizing part takes over, and sometimes when the fluctuations is over is only what was sort of predicted to happen, and then the stabilizing part would be more important. Yeah, good. Okay. Do you want to write a paper then?
I am Mustafa from option B. My question is, I suppose, slightly linked to the just-in-time question, but it's more around services and virtual goods, because obviously they're not covered by these kinds of models, because there's no analog for inventories in the services or when you're selling virtual goods. Do you have any idea around how much of that those types of goods are part of national accounts, and so how much are you missing in your model by leaving that out of?
No, I'm not leaving them out because they're part of the consumption, right? So when there's consumption is not only for finished good, but like for durable goods, is consumption of services too. And they are a very large part, but it's not incompatible with this. And that's part of the, right on the first stylized facts, I said inventories per se are small. And that's what you're saying. So I don't have the numbers, but it's something, the service industry is like enormous, right? 50% of, and that's part of it. So you have, that's your entire GDP, 50% of it is service, and there's no inventories play no role of that. And then you have the other types of industries, and some of them have inventory, and that's why you have 1% of GDP is investment in inventory. So inventories are a small portion of everything that is being transacted. That's true. But nevertheless, they are a volatile portion, and that's the bit that we're trying to explain. Yeah. Once GDP drops, the inventories are an important portion of the GDP drop, more than in the service, right? That's the point.
I'm Habib Hassan from option B. So my question is, if we look at what makes the inventories, like if you look at the financial aspect of this, we have too many debt. You can easily get debt from the banks and other money market and financial services. If there is any disruption in financial market, or if there is any policy changes in the interest rate or something like that, then how it can affect the inventories? So is there any possibility to look at that in future or in any instantaneous time, that due to any change in the cycle, if you look at the Kalinskian financial instability hypothesis, if there is any kind of financial instability, so how it will affect inventories?
I don't think it will affect inventories directly. I think that's the other part of the model. That's why I wanted to have a model that has inventories, but it has debt finance investment. So that will affect the debt finance investment. So that's the traditional King model. So that's why I thought, the Franke model is incomplete, because it exactly doesn't. So in the Franke model, you have the inventory cycles, and you can do whatever you want with the interest rates, and nothing will change. So I wanted to link that to a model that has some financial instability for other reasons. So what is the reason of the financial instability there? Is the traditional channel in the Keene model. There's a large so if there's an increase in interest rate, not many firms are going to be able to repay their debts. So they're going to contract investment because they cannot pay the debt, and because in the Keene model, investment determines directly production, then that will bring production down and will increase unemployment. Now, in a model like this, the point is that it's a sort of less direct step, but it will still be there. The point of proving that the bad equilibrium still exists is that it is still ultimately a factor. Even though, you know, production is not, demand and output are not exactly linked to capital, you do have investment as a big component of aggregate demand, then that will bring down aggregate demand and will bring down expected sales, and bringing down expected sales will bring down utilization, and that will bring the investment down even more, because now if there is no utilization, why you should invest? So the same sort of spiraling mechanism that leads to a recession caused by an increase in interest rate is still there. It might be more indirect, but it's still there.
Next one.
Okay. Well, my name is Matheus. I'm from Option B.
Are you also from Brazil?
Yeah.
Nobody's called Matheus outside Brazil. Yes.
That's a thing, isn't it? So my question is, what is the potential for modelizing? It goes with the question of interest rates. So, What is the potential for modelizing interest rates as a perception of risk, and then modelizing this perception of risk with climate change?
Oh, this.
Yeah. If you say, "Oh my God," then I might as well revise some things.
No, it's because each is a huge question. So in terms of interest rate and risk itself, so in the original Keene model, it was already there. It's just that I and others decided not to look at that, because we thought that there were, you know, other features of the Keene model that had to be addressed first. So, but if you go back to the 1995 paper, there was already the interest rate R was, I think, as it says, phi as the base level plus xi times d over y, where d is the debt of firms. So it was a direct sort of leverage effect. So if debt goes up, then the interest rate goes up. What that does is that, you know, you have your regular equation that d dot is going to be d times r plus growth minus inflation minus something else. Now, if this R itself depends on D, there's going to be an extra D in there. So there's going to be a D square term here. So in terms of, and so we did that calculation privately and didn't put in the paper. The point is that you would still have the same sort of good equilibrium and bad equilibrium, except that now the good equilibrium was not going to be a solution of a linear equation, it's a solution of a quadratic equation. But we didn't think that this was enough reason to put it there. And the bad equilibrium would still be there, because once you take 1 over d, then they're still going to have, even with the d squared there, this can go to the 1 over d going to 0 is still an equilibrium of the system. So it didn't change. It will change the location of the good equilibrium, but it didn't change the fact that there is something with a finite debt and it has a basin of attraction around it, and if you're outside the basin of attraction, you risk going to infinite debt. It might make it faster because of this quadratic thing here, but because we're only looking at the long run, so in a sense, you know, you would collapse faster with this than without it, but you would still collapse. Okay. Now another interesting thing here is that this is always the lending rate. So this is just, you know, the rate at which you get loans for investment. This is not the policy rate, right? So there's an unexplored, so this is the idea for master thesis or PhD thesis, there's an unexplored link between the Keene model and monetary policy. I think it's because Steve himself doesn't believe in monetary policy for anything, so he didn't want to put it there. But if anybody wants to establish what the link is, it's we can speculate what it is, that monetary policy will be stabilized and blah blah blah. But it hasn't been written down, so we don't. I don't know any more about that. So you could try to think about it. But then you climate change.
Because you know climate change would come in as an increase in the risk perception, and this would lead banks to make loans more expensive.
Right, but they would have to first understand climate change and then quantify climate change and quantify the risk perception. I mean the. Maybe when Gael or some of his students will come here to talk to you, they'll show the model that they are working, where they do link a Keynes model with climate change, but the channel is not the interest rate. The channel is more direct. It's more on the actual output. So there's some capital, but capital doesn't translate in output as it would without climate change. So there's a damage. So it's a decrease, it's a fraction of output that is produced out of capital. And that decrease is what they call the damage function. And the damage function depends on the temperature. The damage function depends on the, temperature. And temperature depends on the amount of emissions. And emissions depend on economic activity. So the Y that comes out of the Keynes model feeds economic activity, that feeds the carbon module of the model, and then there's more carbon that increases temperature, and then the higher temperature that will provide damage to the Y. So that's what that's how the feedback works. But it's a much more sort of a engineering view of climate change. stuff is going to start working less, and there's going to be less productivity. Capital will deteriorate more, so the depreciation rate goes up, and so on. But not on a financial view of climate change. So that might be an interesting added acceleration of the perception of risk, as you're saying. Yeah, could be interesting. Yeah. Are you going to work on that?
Yes.
So it's over. It's the end of the world, just after the climate change.
That's right. Yeah.
No further question. Come on. Oh. Yeah.
So I'm Federico Bass.
I think it's working because it's just feeding to the camera. Yeah.
So I'm Federico Bassi. I'm ancient PhD student here in Paris 13. I actually want to ask you something that I could ask also to other people using the same equation. Yeah. Including so Baldrige and Marglin. So my question is, how could we justify from a theoretical point of view that the investment depends on the profit share? I mean, the profit share could be associated with a low profit rate. So saying that firms invest when the profit share is high could imply that they invest when the profit rate is low. So my question is, how should they look at the profit share before investing and not the profit rate?
Yeah. So in the Keynes model is the same thing, right? Because the constant capital output ratio, so the profit share is just a multiple of the profit rate, right? And so what you're saying is that this model should be written in terms of the profit rate as well, and not this profitability as defined.
I mean, the Goodwin model is expressed in terms of the profit share. But my question
is... Which
is
the same as the profit rate in that model?
No, because the profit rate also depends on the rate of utilization.
Which is constant.
Yeah, but... because it's constant in your model.
So that's
okay.
What I said. In both the Goodwin and the Keynes model, it doesn't matter which one you pick. Now in here, if we had decided to use... So we defined pi e, and that was this guy divided by py. So if I had a different one, pi e tilde, where I would say is this divided by k or pk, right? So that's y, not phi. Then I would have this is the same pi e that I had there times u, right? So I would have, as you're saying, I would have to have the utilization. So what it means is that the investment function, which I said was a kappa of u and pi e could be written as a another function of u and pi tilde e that involves the profit rate. Pi tilde e is the profit rate. But what is pi tilde e? Is pi e times y. So I can always rewrite it as a function of u and pi e.
Yeah.
As long as you know, I don't introduce extra variables, right? So you see, this is now kappa of u and pi e u. So if you tell me what this function is, I should be able to map it to that function and vice versa, right? Because they depend on more or less the same variable. It's just a more direct impact as opposed to a less direct impact. So you would exacerbate, writing in this way, you would make it more explicit, the dependence on utilization, than in the way that I wrote. But I think the overall behavior of the model would be the same. Do you agree?
Because I didn't think about that the rate of utilization is actually stable.
Yeah.
What about if you had fixed labor costs?
Fixed labor costs. So you're saying C is constant, right? So C for me was, what was it? Was W divided by Y. So W is W, the little w L divided by AL. So what you're saying is that okay. So you're saying that the wage rate is growing at the same rate as productivity.
Well, what I mean is that as the rate of utilization is rising, the profit share is rising. Because the fixed cost per unit would be diminishing, so the profit share would be rising as economic activity, the rate of utilization of capacity
is
higher.
Yeah, but you are assuming that the cost is constant. So what you're assuming is that...
It's a fixed cost, but it's all, you know, it's a proportion of capacity, say.
Uh-huh.
Fixed labor as a proportion of capacity.
Okay. So I wouldn't have an omega equation, right? So omega would... No, I would, because omega...
You still have the omega equation, but it would be a function of the rate of utilization. Right. It would be a negative function of the rate of utilization in the short run.
Okay.
You know, high frequency.
Yeah. I have to think. I've never done it.
Yeah. Topic for another.
Yeah.
I don't know why I saw that one coming.
Yes?
Yeah, so I'm Regina Tan from option A.
Yeah,
I would just like to ask, there was one portion in your equation wherein you mentioned that inventory was recorded at cost. I think you mentioned it as the change
when
in inventory levels.
When you compute nominal output, that's the price times demand plus cost times the change in inventory, whereas the real output is demand plus change in inventory. So
yes.
To go from real to nominal, you multiply this by one and this by the other.
Yeah, and for the change in inventory, it's accounted for according to cost, right? Historical cost.
That's it. That's this parameter here. Yeah, so if the total actual output is demand plus change in inventory, and then to compute the nominal output is the price times whatever was sold times the plus the cost times the change in inventory.
Yeah, actually, my question is with regards to the cost, because you mentioned that different companies have different inventory management. For example, last in, first in, first out.
Yeah.
But not all, I mean, yes, it would produce a, let's say, level of inventory, but depending on their, for example, product as well, and for example, the environment, for example, if it's last in, first out, and let's say their product is oil, in an inflationary environment, it would push their profit up.
Yeah.
Because, for example, the cost of the old product would be cheaper than the new product.
Yeah.
And they're selling at last in, first out. And it would be different if they have a different inventory policy.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering how it would have any effect on that.
They are allowed by national accounts to to specify what it is. But when they actually compute it for like the NEPA tables, they pick one method, and I just follow what Mark had in the book. And so there's one point in the book, or maybe it's in a paper by Godley, that they say, of all this inventory accountant things, the only one that is that makes sense is either FIFO or FILO, and that's the one that I decide.
Just a small comment on this.
Introduce yourself.
My name is Andrei Shapoval, option A. It's just a comment that, for information, according to IFRS, which are applied in European Union, the LIFO is prohibited. Is prohibited, is not allowed to use the LIFO, the last in, first out.
Right.
According to GAAP, the United States standards, it's allowed exactly. Yeah, yeah. So in Europe, it's only first in, first out.
Okay.
That's why. But if I just already took the microphone, then I have just a small question. Yeah. That's from the same perspective of accountancy and valuation of inventories, how do you account?
Before you ask your question, so you would agree with my method of accounting for me?
Yeah, absolutely.
You would or not?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
good.
But no, it's fine. Just a small comment that how do you treat the concept of impairment of assets? I mean, the slow-moving inventory that is accounted for more than 1 year on the balance sheet. Does it have some influence, according to you, on?
So say again, what is the concept?
The concept of assets impairment. So the assets which are not used in the operating activities for more than 1 year. So there is a certain part of inventory on the balance sheet that are actually not used. So they're in warehouse, but they're not using.
Yeah.
And usually the auditors, they just write off this.
No, I think
I don't know, because I'm not really good with dynamic modeling. It's just...
Yeah. No, I think you're now doing a sort of a refinement on the accounting rules that we didn't take into account. Yeah. So I think we would then create a couple of more items in the balance sheet structure and say, this is the actual items that we're calling inventory, and this is something that we're calling assets that are done for this or that, and that would create a couple of more balance sheet items to keep track. No, we're just clumping it all together.
You're taking information from national accounts, right?
Yeah.
And this comes from financial stuff. Okay, I got it. Thank you. Who's taking the microphone?
We go. So in the one last question.
I forgot to introduce myself. I'm Maria Ruptova. I'm a PhD student here, and I was in EPOG 2 years ago.
Two years ago?
In EPOG this master. So you are explaining the actual inventory change, right? But I was thinking just about the beginning of the discussion about the desired level of inventories.
Yeah.
My intuition would be that if the desired level of inventory decreases because a lot of sectors switch to the production
just in time,
My intuition would be that it would just increase the volatility in the short run, because if it's right on time, it means that probably employment share and capital utilization would be more volatile, right?
I think you're right, and so you wouldn't have the absorption that the inventories that are there provide, and then you. So in a sense, you would still have all the short-term counter-cyclical, the high-frequency counter-cyclical stuff, without any of the pro-cyclical thing that percolates through the system, which is one of the features that we have in the model where we put FD equals to zero. Yeah. It's just a long-run model where discrepancies are instantaneously absorbed by unplanned changes in inventory, and if you have unplanned stuff, then it doesn't propagate into the future for a rebound that is characterized by inventory, because you don't look at it, right? You just let your inventory be whatever it is, because it's not part of your production plans, to replenish inventory if it's down, or to stop producing if it's up. It doesn't play a role.
Okay. Can we have those?